Welcome, everyone, and thank you for listening to the Higher Calling Podcast. I'm Pete Newsom, and this is your source for all things hiring, staffing, and recruiting. I'm welcomed today by James Lund, who I'm very excited to have on the podcast. James is a vice president and co-owner of ProFocus, one of the top IT staffing companies in the country based out of Portland. And James and I have gotten to know each other over the last couple of years through TechServe Alliance, and he's someone who I've been very impressed by as far as being someone I know is going to do great things in the staffing industry above and beyond what he's already done as one of the brightest young leaders in our space. So I'm honored to have him on today. James, thanks so much for joining.
Yeah, appreciate you having me. And thanks for the kind words.
You've been with ProFocus how long now?
I'm 5 years as of this month.
5 years. So talk a little bit about ProFocus. What differentiates you guys in the space? Every time we talk, I hear about innovative, creative things you guys are doing. So how would you present ProFocus to someone who wasn't familiar with the organization?
Yeah, I share the word technology staffing and consulting company. And for a lot of people, that's unique because we're tech only. So we specialize only in technology, and a lot of staffing companies, they do a little bit of everything. You know, they have a mix of various verticals, and we only do tech. And so that's one thing that I think is a key differentiator for us. It's great for our recruiters because they are, and our salespeople, because they're really focused on the technology. I think it's really, really important for us to stay down that path. So, and that's just one of the differentiators I would say is being tech only. But In terms of our market, I think we're doing a lot of really, really interesting things that are deviating from what you see within technology staffing in general, or staffing in general. So you mentioned innovative things. I didn't come from staffing. So for me, when I started about 5 years ago, we're about 7 or 8 years old now. We've been growing rapidly every year over year, internally is just really exciting growth that we've been seeing. But we look at it from a lens, not just what typical staffing companies will do, from a reward system, from culture. We'll dive deep into this too, I'm sure, with some of the topics we'll have. But it's just exciting to be able to approach this and have, you know, our founder and president's support to really look at this, you know, as an organization and kind of revisit, you know, common norms that you would see in staffing and doing things differently for our team, as well as our consultants and our clients.
We've gotten to know each other over the past 2 years, roughly, since coming together through a roundtable from our joint association with TechServe Alliance. And I've been so impressed by the way you and John, your partner, who founded ProFocus, seem to, you know, have a clear, you know, difference in your approach to the way you look at things. It's something that I think my company, Four Quarter Resources, does as well. And maybe that's why I'm so attracted to it, is that you really make it personal and are not too concerned with how things have been done for a long time in the past in our industry. You're looking to do the things that really makes sense today, from your employees and for your clients. So I do want to dive into that, but let's start with a little high level. We kind of jumped right into everything, and you're in Portland, I'm in Orlando, polar opposite sides of the country. How are things going right now? Talk a little bit about the market in Portland.
Yeah, the market is really strong. We're pretty excited about it. We have a lot of clients here that are poised for a lot of growth, and really the main challenge is the talent. So we have a lot of companies that have been growing this year and plan and their roadmap to grow a lot more over the next couple of years here in Portland. And you know, we have clients beyond Portland, but this is, you know, our primary market. But you know, we just actually do an annual Portland Tech Trends survey. It's a report just focused on the Portland metro area, you know, or Pacific Northwest as well, of all of our clients and tech leaders across the Pacific Northwest, and asking them about what they're seeing in the market, what they foresee over the next year. And that was really exciting to see that it was really full steam ahead from that. Well, that report should come out in the next few weeks. And we've just been gathering all of those responses and digging into that over the last couple of weeks. And it's exciting to see that our clients and at least leaders across technology here in the Portland area are seeing a lot of optimism. They're seeing a lot of optimism for a ton of growth. And the main challenge they're seeing, at least so far, is that, you know, the talent side. That's the biggest challenge, retaining and acquiring talent.
Well, give us a little bit more of a teaser to that. Was there anything that surprised you from the results of the survey?
One thing that was surprising was the acquiring talent, if I recall correctly, was obviously the number one challenge, but it was surprising to see retention was lower. I mean, it was number two, but in terms of it being a top challenge, retention was not as high as I would have expected, especially based on what we're hearing about the great resignation or some call it the great reassessment. But retention was not as high as some of us thought it would be, you know, in terms of just seeing that as a top challenge. It was still a high, it was still quite high, but it seemed like acquiring the talent was a far, far larger challenge for those that took the survey here in the Pacific Northwest, as opposed to retaining.
That is interesting, because we all always hear and I think believe that retention is so much easier than having to go out and acquire new talent. So given what we're facing right now, I that is very surprising. I would have expected that to be the number one issue for sure, but not the case. So what about, so what are you guys doing on that? Let's talk a little bit about retention, because I know it's something that is important to all staffing companies right now, because we're seeing a big battle for talent in this space. We're seeing a lot, at least in Florida, I'm not sure if you guys are as well, we're seeing a lot of staffing companies lose recruiters to corporate entities who are building up their teams in a greater way than they historically have done. So at ProFocus, what are you guys doing to counter that?
We do a lot of things. We do a lot.
I know.
So,
you do.
Yeah. So this is something I take really seriously. Is we want to keep our team members, and you know, it's one of our four core strategies. You know, one of them, it's the one that's most important to me, is making this an amazing place to work. So retention is really important. People enjoying their work, people coming to work and actually liking what they do and loving the company, is really important. So we do a lot to take this really seriously, from gathering feedback, listening, involving our team members in the big picture of the company and helping us grow, helping us improve. I think first though, people quit people. They don't quit companies. You hear that. I firmly believe that ultimately, even if you are doing a lot at the top and you have great benefits and great pay and all of that, ultimately if individuals don't love their bosses, I think they're going to leave. And so we take a lot of attention to making sure that we have good leaders across the organization, and that we're developing good leaders, that we're promoting good team members into leadership, that are knowing it's a different position, that we're preparing them for leadership. So to me, I think that's a really important part of our retention strategy, is having good people across the organization that are leading and supporting our team members. But there's a lot going on. You mentioned leaving for leaving the agency world for going internal, and there's going to be a certain amount of that's going to happen. And with the money being thrown out from some companies to go internal, it's pretty remarkable. I think it will be interesting to see once they fill their teams and what happens with those individuals that will, inevitably, or some will inevitably get laid off. That's a risk some people take. And I know I've talked to internal team members over the years that's a factor. They know, they can go chase that. And sometimes they know it's maybe worth it to go, get that whatever that sweet offer is to, be remote, recruit for Amazon or wherever it is. And then maybe when they do some cutbacks, then at least with agency, I think for us, for that retention, our best performers don't ever leave for agency. Don't ever leave the agency for internal because of the compensation differences. And once they've built up a good book of business, whether the market changes or not, you're in control of your employment, really.
Correct. Yes. Yeah,
And
and it's
yeah.
I've wondered about that quite a bit as we've seen, we've experienced departures from our own internal staff, and as much as we try to avoid it, but we end up filling, unlike you guys, we do a lot of non-IT positions. And the number of recruiter roles that we've been asked to fill, it's sort of ironic in a way, for our own clients has been unlike anything we've seen in our 16 years in business, not even close. We historically would get them sporadically, but we're seeing them by the dozens almost, and have over the past few months. And to your point, it does beg the question, what happens when things normalize? What happens when things begin to subside, which they will eventually? Those teams aren't going to probably be as big as they are today. So that's something that will be interesting to see how it plays out. You also touch on the Great Resignation, and I wanted to get your take on this. That one of the things that I have not heard referenced much at all is that the baby boom generation was going to be retiring. We've been hearing about that for the last 10, maybe even 20 years, that it was going to cause a shortage in the workforce. I have not heard that referenced at all in terms of the Great Resignation, which incidentally was a term coined pre-COVID. The guy who came up with that phrase was a professor at Texas A&M in 2019. So he anticipated this coming, and now that it's here and we've seen such a shortage in the workforce, no one mentions the baby boomers retiring. Is that something that you guys have thought about at all, or why do you think there's such a problem right now?
Yeah, I think I actually did. I hadn't heard much about the baby boomers for a while, but I did in a conversation in Texas a couple weeks ago. I did hear someone, or maybe it was actually one of the presenters, was talking about boomers and that they are, but they didn't quite all retire when it was expected. And it's really just been a slow process of that happening. So it's interesting to see. But in terms of, I really do think. I've heard about the great reassessment. I know there's the great resignation and some of the great reassessment. I really think that that's a good way to define this. I think a lot of people had more options than ever before in terms of their employment choice and their career choice. And that's one thing that I think stands out this, as opposed to just resigning, is now because there's so much opportunity, whether people leaving the workforce or just because there's just so many more jobs than there were before. I think we're seeing a lot more people really evaluating what they want to do with their career and leaving companies that they just maybe their jobs they don't love, companies they don't love, and assessing their future.
A lot of changes that are taking place as we speak, needless to say. And we've all had to adapt to changes forced upon us by COVID, through the pandemic, closures. Things are different in your part of the world than they are in Florida, where I am. How has ProFocus navigated that? If you wouldn't mind touching on both how you've handled it internally as well as with your clients, how it's changed relationships, for the good and bad maybe. But I know you guys have obviously done a lot to make sure that you're ahead of the curve.
In terms of our internal retention?
Yeah, talk about both. Start with internal.
We fortunately in 2021, we just didn't have the type of turnover that I was hearing from my colleagues across the country. And I know this is generally a business with a lot of turnover. I know there's desirable and undesirable turnover. I would say for the most part, like I said, we did not lose very many of our team members that were high performers. We just didn't. We lost one, I think, of our higher performers that chose to leave the industry and just pursue what that person wanted to do with their career. And that person was a younger individual that was still just figuring out what they wanted to do, and we fully supported that transition. Aside from that, for the most part, we didn't lose really very many people. Maybe one other person that in terms of a higher performer, we for the most part, our turnover was pretty good. So we didn't see that great resignation or the great reassessment, or I know that we've heard and talked about with colleagues across the country that they've seen a lot of their recruiters leave for agency, or sorry, leave the agency for internal, or leaving to other agencies that had better comp models, or what have you. We didn't see that, fortunately.
Well,
So.
So not to share too many secrets, but that's unique. That's an anomaly. We know that from our time at TechServe a couple weeks ago at the conference. It was probably the most prevalent conversation that was happening, both on side conversations as well as what the presenters were addressing. What do you attribute that to with ProFocus? Obviously, you guys are doing something very right to be in the position you're in.
Yeah, I think it's a combination of things, and just in general, our company as a whole, we really look at ways, a lot of different ways that we can improve the experience for our team members. I mean, our mission is to create exceptional experiences for every one of our candidates, clients, and team members. And so when we think of that, our mission is not just focused on our candidates and clients, it's our internal team members as well as our consultants that are out working at our, client locations. So we're for our clients. So one of the things I think 2019, we did improve our comp plan. So of course, compensation, there's only so much you can do with retaining people with fringe benefits and work-life balance, or just really supporting them and having good bosses. If you're not paying them competitively, you'll most likely lose them. I think there's a certain degree that people will give up in terms of comp that for a really good situation that they could be at from a workplace, standpoint. So I think that that's one that is a factor. 2019, prior to this, we improved our comp plan. We really took a look at it, evaluated how we can make it more generous, especially to our higher performers. So that was one thing that was really important for us, making sure that the math worked, of course, but to where we could be as generous as we reasonably could, and for our comp plan for higher performers. It's not as generous for someone that's underperforming. So that was a shift that we made, and we don't want to change our comp plan very often, but this was one that I thought it needed to be improved in order to make sure that we could retain our higher performers.
So you were ahead of the curve with that, for sure.
Yeah, and that was just something I think it was lucky on the timing, but we just evaluated different things that we can improve, and that was one that was really important to make sure that we were able to acquire and retain the right folks. We have been growing quite a bit, and internal hiring, that's a really important piece. When somebody looks at the comp plan, they want to make sure that they can reasonably make, whatever their target income is. So.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's so important in our space. All we really have is our employees and the value that they deliver in the market. Our brand, our name only goes so far. That's not going to get the job done. And so I commend you for being an early. You solved a problem before you avoided a problem by taking those steps. I think
Yeah.
that's probably the best way to phrase it. I want to find out what's changed with your client relationships or the impact you've seen from COVID. But if you wouldn't mind, you mentioned that there you guys operate on four core principles. I'm not sure exactly how you phrased it. Would you share those with us?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's four core strategies that we have, and it helps us guide our decisions as a business, and so that we are all on the same page about what our priorities are. We just had our all company annual strategic retreat last week, and half the day is dedicated to talking about our core strategies and sharing ideas and discussing ideas and brainstorming ways that we can improve our execution in those areas. And it's the first one is high quality, high touch. So we want to really deliver high. We want to have high quality relationships. We want to have with both our candidates, consultants, and our clients. And we want to have direct access. We really need to be successful to have direct access to the decision maker who's going to be making the hiring decision. So that's really important for us. That's how we can deliver our quality. The second one is exceptional service. So being a FRED, if anyone's listening that has read FRED Factor, it's a great book. It's a quick read, but I think it's really important for us that we're delivering exceptional experience. I think in our industry, it's shocking to me. I didn't come from the staffing industry 5 years ago, but it's shocking to me the low bar that our industry has for service. I think it's remarkable. It makes it really easy, I think, to be able to provide exceptional experiences for our candidates and for our clients, because a lot of bad recruiters, just like a lot of bad salespeople, have given the industry a bad rap, right? I mean, it's remarkable. And so that's a core strategy of ours.
There are some bad players. I want you to finish talking about these strategies, but I think the commoditization of the staffing industry has helped contribute to that in a really negative way. When you talk about high touch, I don't know how you could hire well without that. And there's an entire line of businesses, I won't name names. You and I both know who they are, who exist to take the touch out of it, to take the personalization out of staffing, which to me is just insane because it's one of the most intimate things you could do in the business world. We all acknowledge, at least I hope everyone acknowledges, that your employees will make or break your organization. And so to try to commoditize that is something that has never made sense to me. It's a space that we don't play in. It's a space that you guys don't play in, but that certainly hasn't elevated the perspective of our industry, in my opinion.
No, absolutely.
And so I hope that trend, I think it's going away a little bit. I think the value of how hiring happens is certainly at top of mind for everyone right now, given the conditions of the job market. So I hope one of the byproducts of that will be the realization that this is not something that should be commoditized, that something should be elevated
Absolutely.
at all cost. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree.
So continue on though. I just wanted to throw that in there because I know it's something that you agree, you and I've had lengthy conversations about already and see as important, and we hope that others will see that as important as well.
Yeah, and that space is, that space is great for some, and that's just not the one that we've decided that is the right one for us. So at least not at this time. So for us, it's really important that we stay, so we can, we have really high expectations in terms of our quality. In our quality ratios and quality metrics with, from fill ratio to sub to interview, sub to placement, all those kinds of things. And, we know that we have a harder chance to win if we're not accessed, you don't have access to the manager. So the other two real quick, I had already referenced specialized only in technology and making it an amazing place to work. So those are the four core strategies that we look at. And when we think about how we can improve, better execute on our core strategies, those are the four.
That's great. I love it. And I think that your success is not coincidental as a result of that, because it's not, I know from our exchanges over the past couple of years, it's not something you just talk about. It's something that you guys take very seriously, and you make it, very clear that that's going to be your approach with your employees and with your clients.
Yeah.
And it's really impressive to see from a distance. But talk about your clients a little bit. COVID has changed a lot for many of us. It's made recruiting sometime in some ways easier, I think, where we can have more flexibility in terms of the remote employees and the options that exist there. But it's also made certain things more challenging as we have to navigate different mandates and requirements, both, from a government standpoint, as well as from, an individual company choice standpoint. That's impacting us here in Florida quite a bit, and with our clients throughout the country. How about where you are? What are you seeing there?
So in terms of the overall impact on our clients, I think I mean, there has been a big impact, but I would say that it'll be interesting to see how many of our clients actually do require any of their team members to come back on site. I know that's going to be an interesting one to see, in how much more turnover will there be once some of our clients require going back into the office, whether it's 1 or 2 or 3 days a week. But I know that there's a lot of companies that are clients and companies across the country, they're going to require that. And that'll be interesting to see. But for our clients, it was really interesting that when we did our survey, that a lot of the clients and people in the Pacific, and tech leaders in the Pacific Northwest, they acknowledge that what you reference is that it's a lot easier to acquire and to recruit talent when you are fully remote, when you have that option. It's
Sure.
really, that was, of course, you that makes sense. But I also think it's interesting that a lot of companies and a lot of our clients are threatening to take that away, or having some level of, one day in the office or 2 days in the office. We embraced, is to touch on our, another thing of retention, we embraced office optional. So that's that's totally optional to us at this stage for
Right.
all of our internal team members. And that has made it so much easier for us with our, with recruiting for our clients too. So that's one thing that I see as the biggest, or at least, you know, one of the biggest challenges that we'll see is if more and more of our clients start requiring that, and it really will change how we're able to be successful for them. But for the most part, I think our clients have adapted pretty well. And of course there's a lot of challenges, but for the most part, it seems like they have been growing and growing their teams and headcount, and for the most part embracing remote and continue to do that. So for us, you know, pre-pandemic and to now, a lot of the same challenges that you would have seen before COVID, you know, that we're seeing with our clients.
So have you not, again, difference between Florida and the Pacific Northwest and a lot of other parts of the country where we've been open, as you saw, you know, probably a change when you were here in Jacksonville a couple of weeks ago. It's business as usual for the most part. Companies are trying to navigate how to handle that, where everyone can be on site, but it's optional, and it becomes a competitive advantage or disadvantage if you choose to look at it that way. But and I would say we're about 50-50 right now. That is an unscientific number, but half of our clients who we work with regularly want their employees back on site. Others haven't gone there yet, but it sounds like most of yours haven't asked people to come back yet.
For the most part, no. And that's where, you know, to go back to my other comment as well, is you know, when that does happen, it'll be interesting to see how that impacts it. Because like you said, you are all open. We still have, you know, we're still fairly closed. We still have a mask mandate, you know, indoors and in offices, and unless you're in a private room with the door closed. And so a lot of our clients have delayed their back to office plans. And I think, you know, there were a number that we're planning on, you know, in Q4 or, you know, in January, and just a lot of these have been pushed back. And because of, you know, the cases in the mandates here in Oregon. So for the most part, it's still, which is, you know, for people that are listening in Florida or other parts of the country that are open, you know, we're still fairly closed here from, you know, when it comes to the office. So a lot of people are still working remote. Many people have not been mandated to go back in the office yet. And it'll be interesting to see how, you know, how once things do reopen and then companies and our clients start requiring people or looking at their in-office plans and what that is, how that's going to change, you know, our ability to acquire talent for them or, you know, our potentially our turnover of our consultants.
Sure. And it is going to, you know, we have a client right now who is requiring that everyone be vaccinated, which is yeah, something that really our governor in Florida has fought against. And it's made things easier for us because with the mandate, and we're watching it closely. We don't know how that's ultimately going to land. So we feel like we're in purgatory right now, because until we know, we're not sure what actions to take, but selectively we're having to enforce our clients' policies. And one of our bigger clients just decided that everyone has to be vaccinated to come back, and it's going to cause some turnover. We know that. And it's going to be really interesting to see how this plays out, both from a vaccine standpoint, as well as coming back to the office standpoint, because the decision that you make is going to determine, you know, how easy or difficult it is going to be to staff. It's going to reduce the candidate pool if you start making additional requirements, and that's just math at that point.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm really curious. I'm not necessarily looking forward to seeing how it all plays out, but I'm curious to observe over the next probably year. We'll see a lot of things unfold, don't you think?
Yeah, and we have a number of clients that have already mandated it. You know, having vaccine, you know, being vaccinated is a mandate if you're on site. And so for a lot of the folks that we have placed, and if they're never going to be on site, that may or may not impact them, depending on the clients. So some clients, whether you're on site or not, maybe they'll have that mandate. You know, if you're in the Portland area, obviously there's a lot more folks that are vaccinated than not here in Portland. And I think of it as similar to, you know, it's interesting. It's not the same, but I do think it's a little bit similar to marijuana. So we in Portland and Oregon, and you know, marijuana is legal. So you can do that. And
you guys are recreationally legal too, right?
Absolutely.
It's just legal for everyone. Is it, I don't know this. I probably should, but is it 18? Is it 21? What is the,
you know, I think it's 18.
Okay.
I don't actually know the answer to that question.
Okay.
There's no reason for me to know
the answer to that. I'm just curious.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I don't know for sure. I think it's 21, but you know, or I actually don't know. But it is interesting though, because we have some clients that, you know, we'll just, when we do drug screen, we don't test for that because the clients don't care. It's not required. And then we have some clients that it is required because maybe, you know, for whatever reason, federally or their customers or what have you, for whatever reason, it's not allowed. And so that would be tested. So that's one thing we've done. I think of that as similar to the mask, you know, similar to the vaccine is, you know, hey, this job requires you to, you know, you can't smoke marijuana. You have to pass a drug screen, which will include marijuana. This requires you to be vaccinated. Hey, this requires you to pass a background check. All those kinds of things. It's just one more thing by client for us to manage. And like you said, it will reduce the talent pool. I do think this is a little bit, obviously it's different than the marijuana thing, but it is similar in regards to reducing the talent pool, but also not quite as much, I think, because we are able to hire, and a lot of our clients are remote, and the vaccine won't necessarily apply if they're considered a permanently remote position.
Sure. Well, I think it's a very appropriate analogy to use with the marijuana, because we've seen companies, I've yet to see someone who didn't have a test for it start requiring it, but lots of examples of organizations who've made the decision that it was too limiting to their talent pool and have raised the requirement. One of our larger clients just said that not only did they say we can stop testing for it, anyone who passed or failed a drug test for marijuana, they wanted us to go back and reconsider. Because they realized who knows what their thought process is. I don't want to speak for them, but I suspect it was because they realized it was too limiting and it was impacting their business in a negative way. And I know that that's going to happen with companies with either coming back on site or the vaccine mandate. And it's kind of a fascinating rabbit hole to go down, if not that we will, but to think how you have to balance your business, what's good for your business versus what, you know, may be a moral or ethical or principled decision for you, right? But if it's going to hurt your bottom line, those things tend to not be as important, right? Like, you know, so it may seem important now, but if you can't get employees, you know, it's going to be difficult. And as you know, everything's a sliding scale. If you can have low salaries, but it's going to limit your pool. You raise your salaries, you get more, you get more candidates to choose from. It's just math.
Absolutely.
So touch on that though, real quick. We just updated our 2022 salary guide, published it a couple weeks ago. And even though I have been living the increased salaries over the past 6 months, I was shocked to see really the comparison from 2021 to 2022. We're up about 15% across the board is how our numbers ended up coming out that we published. Does that surprise you, or are you seeing something similar in Portland?
It doesn't surprise me. I don't know what the actual numbers are for us from 2021 or 2020, you know, in terms of what the percentage would be, but it's certainly up. And I was thinking probably in that 10% range, and it depends on the skill set too. So we're seeing some skill sets that are going a lot higher, and sometimes candidate demands that are just, you know, where maybe the budget for the client side isn't meeting it. So that will be a challenge, of course, that, you know, we've talked with clients as well and trying to, even though you would think a lot of companies and hiring managers would understand the talent shortage. And I mean, it's basic econ 101, right? Supply and demand, the price goes up. And so that's what we're seeing as well. And it, of course, it depends on the skill set.
It's a byproduct of everything that's happened. And at times, I just mentioned this to someone on my last podcast that we were talking about hospitality industry and travel. And, you know, that I was interviewing the CEO of the American Resort Development Association, who's also a friend. And we were talking about how it affects how the pandemic has affected family life and the time that you've spent together and the way you value time together. It's really a silver lining among all the bad. And you almost feel guilty identifying those things at times. But one of those silver linings for the staffing industry is that not only is it less commoditized than it was, at least that's how I think it's evolving, but the value of folks in our position and to be consultative in our discussions with senior executives at our clients, which is sometimes it's not always something we do in the staffing world, because it's almost viewed as a commodity, the act of hiring. I think we've been elevated there too, because those discussions aren't just, you know, complaints or excuses as to why a position is unfilled. It's a lot more serious than that. And we're even having discussions, which again, in 16 years in business, I don't think I did with any regularity. It's very infrequent, where we'd say, if you don't raise your prices, it's not a good expenditure of our time. Like it just makes no sense for us to work on your position. And those conversations were often dismissed in the past.
Yeah.
But they're not anymore. And that's to me a silver lining for employees. It's a silver lining for everyone in the staffing industry as well.
Yeah, and it was always, I mean, this has always been present, right? This has always been an issue, but it's certainly when you have so much need in your clients, I mean, a lot of clients and a lot of job orders, there's so much demand out there that we fortunately are in a position to where we can be a little bit more picky and have those conversations and turn business away. Right.
Right.
Whereas before, you know, the client could make their terms and say, well, you know, but that's what we're working with from a budget perspective. And
it's a tough conversation to have. It's a risky conversation unless you know you're 100% correct. And what I mean is, mm-hmm. if our sales people in the past, and I did it too when I was selling, I'd want to tell the client, you have to raise your rate on this and draw a line in the sand. Yeah. That's a tough thing to do if you're not completely sure. You shouldn't do it unless you're completely sure, because another company may come in behind you, fill the position, and credibility is immediately lost. So yeah. Now there's a much greater comfort level, I think, with having those conversations, because it's just the situation is ripe for it in a way, and it's overdue. There hasn't been a big shift. I think inflation, you know, for the most part, has probably been outpacing salary increases. So to me, I think it's almost a right sizing to some degree, but it'll be interesting to see how far that goes, right? Will these salaries continue to increase? Because the gap of open jobs to employees or candidates able to fill those jobs, it's not shrinking, it's only growing. And I'm not sure where that's going to lead.
Yeah, I'm not either. I think one thing that you touched up on, I think of the more we can stretch the job order, I think at this point, I think right now, like you said, it's a great time to have these conversations. But I also don't think it's as challenging or difficult of a conversation to have that I think some people are so fearful of pushing back with hiring managers and pushing back with our clients and having those, you know, what could be considered a tougher conversation. And that I think it's really just sharing our expertise. It's yes. sharing our knowledge and take it or leave it, customer. This is what we're seeing in the market. And like you said, it will make us look bad if our competitors go in and fill it at the rate that they wanted to. And it doesn't mean it's impossible. We can just be transparent with that and say, hey, you know, maybe we can, but I can tell you from what we're seeing, the vast majority of candidates are coming in here.
Right.
And you can run that risk that you can go unfilled, but yeah, I think it's appropriate to have those conversations. It's necessary, especially right now. But I don't think it's a matter of, oh, we're necessarily, you know, going to turn the business away. A lot of times it's just educating the client and helping them understand and just trying to see where we can stretch the job order trying to see where we can get them to at least increase the max so that we can say, hey, how about you at least compare? You know, maybe we can get you someone at that rate, but do you want to see someone here 10 or 15 or 20K higher that maybe has a lot more experience and maybe is a much better fit that's going to be of better value to you, and maybe they can help bring up other more junior developers or whatever the position is that can add a lot more value to the team at a more appropriate market rate. So, and then they can take it or leave it.
Absolutely. And that's why I've always thought of it as a sliding scale, right? Yeah. If you want to pay less, you're going to get less. And yeah. It really is no different than any other asset. But it's an interesting time where those conversations are just more, I'm finding companies are more open to it, and they do see us as that authority. You and I would argue they always should have. I just don't think that's always been the case. And when you look at the prevalence of the VMS space that we touched on a little bit ago, that's evidence enough that, you know, we want to hire employees at the cheapest possible rate with as little effort as possible. And you and I would say, I think, I don't want to speak for you, so tell me if I'm wrong, that should never be the goal. The goal should be to hire the best employee, let the market dictate the rate, and the more touch and time extended up front, the better. Because if you don't expend that time, you're taking a chance, right? You're guessing, and that's not ever how hiring should happen, I don't think.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I definitely agree with you. I think when you think of the VMS, it's trying to solve a problem. Like when we talked about the bad players earlier, it's trying to solve that problem that the bad players that are submitting way too many candidates, or that they're not finding the right candidates, or they're trying to, you know, because trying to feel like we're seeing the staffing industry as staffing individuals as really just, you know, being too expensive. And they're just trying to put some control on it. Whereas if they had a good partner like you or like ProFocus or other good, there's a lot of really good staffing companies across the country that we know many of those individuals that are doing the right thing and that are fair. They work closely with their clients. And if all staffing companies were like that, VMS, I think, would not exist. There wouldn't be any.
Right. But you said the word that, you know, we don't want to throw around too much, but I do think it is the perfect one for the situation that we're in. And it really is an opportunity to be a partner, more so than any time that I know of in staffing, we can be that. And I think ProFocus, just like us, we've always attempted to be a partner. We've looked for organizations who can see us as such, but the opportunity to do that at a bigger scale, I think, exists right now. And that's why it's a good time to be in staffing. It's a bit of a minefield. We're trying to navigate all of the changes and do so, you know, by paying attention to laws and mandates and just from one state to the next. It's like we're at times we feel like we're living, it may as well be a different country, the way that things are so different. But we have a lot to navigate. But to be a partner and to be seen as that, as you know, it makes all the difference in the world and how the relationship flows. It should be the goal of not only the staffing company, but the hiring entity as well, whether they realize it or not. But again, of course, we think that way because that's the way we strive to do business and really try to almost insist on it in the way we handle our day-to-day operations.
Yeah.
So with that said, I think we've covered a lot of the past. Before we go, what's the outlook for 2022? What do you expect from ProFocus? What can we look forward to?
Well, we are growing. So, and we're continuing to invest in our growth. I think right now there's a real opportunity in the market for us to capture market share. We're, like I said, we were a 7-8 year old company and really excited about the opportunity for us to really get some new clients and really break into some customers and really expand in those with those customers. So for us, we're investing in our team. We're looking to hire. We just rolled out every 6 months. We share an updated ProFocus roadmap with everyone in the company, which details out our goals and our plans from a hiring perspective and looking at our org chart and from the coming year, as well as, you know, 2023, 2024 and beyond. So we share that every 6 months and updates that, as well as progress towards those things. So we're looking to add another probably 50% or close to 50% internal headcount this coming year, which we are really excited about and wanting to continue to invest in our growth, just because we have a number of clients also that we have confidence that we'll be able to grow with them too, in terms of those partnerships. So a lot of opportunities there. We're pretty excited and rolling out some succession planning and looking at ways that we can continue to develop our team members, the ones that are really interested in moving, you know, into new roles with us and into leadership roles. We're partnering with them on their development, and so they can step into those leadership positions as we grow. So for us, we're really excited going into 2022. We need to hire. So perfect podcast to be on, but that's one of the things that we're prioritizing, to bring on new team members and to help drive that growth. This last year, I think we would have grown so much more if we had just, you know, we anticipated this year to be strong. So we hired in anticipation of that and invested in that. We didn't hire enough. So we did not have enough recruiters this year. I'm sure the same for you and most everyone in staffing as well. It's just, oof, man, if we had had a full team, so that, you know, we have a lot of confidence 2022 is going to be strong. And so we're looking to hire even more people for that growth and to help drive that, so we can deliver for our customers, because we have a lot of really good customers and clients, and we want to make sure that we can show up for them and get them the right team members for their projects and for their company.
Well, I hope your presence on Higher Calling today gives us some more listeners in the Pacific Northwest, because I will say to anyone who's listening there, after observing you and John and the way you go about business and everything I've heard you share over the past 2 years, I feel very confident saying that anyone who has the opportunity to be an employee of ProFocus internally or to work with you guys as a client or contractor is going to be treated extremely well, and that's unique. I feel very strongly about that. I don't say it lightly. And you guys are doing things the way they should be done. That should be a given. It's far from a given in the marketplace, and it's rare. And that's why you're succeeding. And that's why I have no doubt that you're going to not only meet but surpass all your goals and objectives. So let's bookmark this time, and next December we'll come back on, if you'd come back on, if you'd be so kind to do that, then we'll recap the year. And I know you guys are going to have a great one, and I can't thank you enough for coming on. It's a busy time with your 5 kids at home, right? Are you still at 5?
We're still at 5, and we're done at 5. So that is it. I committed to 5. So, you know, the joke I always share is that, you know, my wife wanted 5, I wanted 2. And so we compromised and had 5. So, but that's it. I'm done.
No Perfect. More. Well, it's nice when I get to speak with someone who has more kids than me, because they can appreciate all the craziness that happens at this time of year, especially. And I hope you guys have a great end of year, and I look forward to talking to you throughout 2022. So James, thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, Pete. Appreciate it.
Awesome. Well, everyone, thanks for listening. As always, if you have any questions, comments, or suggestions for new topics, email us, higher calling at fourcornerresources.com. We'd love to hear from you. Thanks, and have a great rest of the day.